Well, welcome and God bless you. My name is Paul Berry. I'm the senior pastor of Calvary Chapel, Santa Maria. I believe this is a unique opportunity for us on cable access TV to bring you segments of our regular services here. A service that is going to include not only the Word of God, line by line, precept by precept, but also that Word in the power of the Holy Ghost to change your life, even as I've seen it change so many people's lives in our congregation. I believe the Word of God has a unique power, a power that's far beyond the ability of speakers or churches that can affect your life, change your life. Romans 10 verse 17 says, faith comes by hearing, hearing by the Word of God. So as you listen to the Word of God this morning, in the power of the Holy Spirit, let it change you, let it change your neighborhood, let it change the place in which you work, let it change your family, let it change the things that the Lord wants you to occupy until He is the bridegroom, comes for His blessed bride, the church. And I pray that that's soon. God bless you. Jesus says, I go before you to Galilee. And so then, verse 16 of Matthew 28, the 11 disciples went away into Galilee. They're only doing what He told them they would find Him doing. Imagine Jesus, some have suggested that Jesus in an instant transported Himself from Jerusalem to the Galilee. I like to think that Jesus took the same walk. I don't know if it would have taken the majority of those 40 days after the crucifixion for Him to walk to the Galilee and back. Probably would me. How many of you would love to take a 125-mile walk? Let's start this afternoon. And by the way, you only get to walk on thin sheets of leather for all 125 miles. So just think with me this romantic idea that He now is leaving Jerusalem with literally tens of thousands of Jews who have been camping there for the week, and now they're heading back home. Some are heading down the hill to Jericho, up the Jordan River. They're following the same traditional paths that they would three times every year in the ceremonial feasts of Israel. Now they're heading home. Imagine Jesus walking with them. He's the guy that seems to be constantly glowing. Who is that guy, you know? That's kind of how I would think of that. But for the sake of time, maybe Jesus just stepped into the veil of eternity and out and then in Galilee. The disciples have returned. They had to walk, I'm sure of it. They got back to Galilee and they've assembled in that place that Jesus said He would meet with them. An appointment, as it were, in verse 16. He says, the 11 disciples went away into Galilee to the mountain which Jesus had appointed for them. Note, please, first, that there is a disciple missing in this verse. Not 12 disciples, 11 disciples. And among them, of note, is Peter. He who denied Christ three times. And note, he who's missing, who ultimately denied Christ the most in committing Him to be arrested for the cause of cash and then killing himself as he thought concerning what in fact he had done. The 11 disciples have walked back to Galilee. It could be that the mass of those that were following Jesus prior to this, some 120 that later in just a few weeks would be found in the upper room prior to Pentecost, maybe they all walked together. Maybe they all made their way to Galilee. And the disciples, the 11 of them, have climbed the mountain where they were familiar with meeting with Jesus. And Jesus has spoken through Matthew in the Holy Spirit to say, listen, I've got an appointment with you. And isn't it wonderful to know that Jesus never misses His appointments? He's never late for them. I like that. I like to think that every time I sit down and I open the Bible, that Jesus is right there with me. I like to think that I'm sitting with Jesus. I like to think that He who is our glorious Holy Spirit is sitting right there with me. Jesus has appointed you to certain divine appointments as well. You've probably recognized as a Christian that there are times when you encounter certain situations when you kind of wonder, how did this happen? Lucy and I really see these divine encounters as an appointment that God had set up. I don't understand how it happens. I don't understand how it is that you might turn a corner and there's somebody that God had appointed for you to meet. I love that. And I've begun, as it were, both of us, to search for those. We go to odd places at times, and even in those odd places, I attend your church. Well, first of all, sorry because I didn't know that. But secondly, what a great joy. And realize that God did that for something more than you may think initially God had in it. Enjoy your divine appointments. Enjoy the encounters that Jesus brings to you. These are the appointments as Jesus had with his disciples. These are the appointments where God's agenda is at hand. These are the appointments where something can happen that could change eternity. Not only for the person that you're ministering to, but friends, it always turns around and brings eternity for us as well. Which mountain? That's a good question. I ask that question. Maybe you're not asking it. But I've been to Israel many times, and I've been to many mountains around the Galilee. And I like to think of the Mount of Beatitudes. It's really more of a hill. And those of you who've been to Israel and have enjoyed the times of standing at the top of that hill, looking down towards the water of the Galilee. Now, we're actually looking down the hill to the south. This is the northern end of the Galilee. To our left, looking at the picture, would be the city of Capernaum, just about a mile up the beach. Directly in front of us is the place where traditionally it is known that Jesus met Peter and the disciples and shared with them a breakfast where he challenged Peter. Peter, do you love me? And of course, Peter, interestingly enough, responds in a very different manner than which I think some of us would respond. But noteworthy in this, as we look down the hill towards this beach on the water, noteworthy in this is that it is Jesus who has come to Peter. Peter did what was expected of him. He went back to the Galilee. But note, please, that it is Jesus that came looking for Peter. Why? Because Peter, his heart was broken. He had denied. He had walked away. He had disassociated himself of Jesus, even while he cursed at the fire at Caiaphas's house. And now Jesus, with great grace and mercy. How I love that about Jesus. Here Jesus is seeking you. Here Jesus is seeking me. Here Jesus is seeking each of us to restore that lovely intimacy of relationship. You see, Jesus wants more. There's times when you've had enough, perhaps. There's been times in my life when I've had enough. And I actually thought being a Christian was more of a debit rather than a credit. But Jesus never thinks that way. In fact, the Gospel of Matthew concludes with this wonderful statement of Jesus saying, "Lo, or behold, I am with you always, even unto the end of the age. You will never be alone." To those who have been changed, blessed, bought by the blood of Jesus, you will never be alone. Isn't it wonderful Jesus looks for you? Isn't it wonderful that Jesus hunts us down? Gail Irwin, who has come several times to our church, shared with us once a rather interesting poem entitled "The Hounds of Heaven." And this poem speaks about the Holy Spirit hunting you down. You see, he doesn't want to abandon you. You may want to abandon him. You may want to deny him. In fact, you may even bear the marks of denial of Jesus, because it never comes out well, friends, believe me. But know this also. Know this by the example of Peter. Know this by the example of Jesus bringing an appointment to the Galileans. I am searching for you. I am looking for that which I once enjoyed, dear Christians, that lovely intimacy of relationship where you knew of my presence and my love. You wondered at it. You marveled at it. And your prayers were reeking of it as my fragrance infused upon you. And it was just a wonderful thing. Oh, how Jesus longs for that more. How he longs for that intimacy once again. I encourage you, oh Christian who perhaps did walk away, oh Christian who perhaps denied him, oh Christian who bears the marks today of the wounds of this world, the wounds of the flesh and the wounds of the devil, simply because you attempted to walk away from he who alone is the glorious potentate of this universe. Oh, know this, that Jesus seeks you today. Know this, that Jesus has set an appointment, and when your heart turns towards the Father's house, know this, he will meet you more than halfway. He will kill the fatted calf. He will seek you endlessly. Please, come today as we close later this morning. Come today back to the fold of God, to the flock of Jesus. He's a shepherd that loves his sheep. From this hillside, looking down the hill, oftentimes Lucy and I will look down this hill and we'll think of all the things that have happened on this hillside. Remember, Jesus met with thousands on this hillside. He spoke the Sermon on the Mount. He spoke teaching and discipling them. He brought to them the content of God's heart, and many received it that day. Great miracles happened, not only in feeding them, but also in reviving these people. Jesus, of course, could have chosen this mountain to meet them. It would have been a very familiar place to the disciples. But what about this other mountain? This is one mountain that stands above all other mountains around the Galilee. Mount Arbel is a place that drops quickly into the Galilee. As you look at this picture to the left, you're looking at the city of Magdala, where Mary came from. There are many excavations around the Galilee. One of the more recent ones have discovered a very ancient first century church at the base of this mountain. And they're just beginning now to piece together where this church came from. And it's been, it is now known very, very well that it was a first century church. I can't wait to get back there and kind of explore that some. They're still working on it, but they love for people to come explore. I think this is the mountain where Jesus has spent the night praying. And he looks down upon the water and he sees his apostles, his disciples struggling at the oars. Jesus spent many nights praying. He who needed to pray the least was found in the Gospels to pray the most. By the way, in the Gospels, all four Gospels, there is not a single prayer recorded by the apostles, by the disciples, not a single prayer. Every prayer in the Gospels is one that Jesus spoke. Isn't that astonishing to think that right now Jesus is praying for you? Right now, before our Father in heaven, Jesus is interceding for you. He is speaking your name, dear child of God, before our Father. That's a wonderful thing to me. I love Israel. I love the Galilee. Both of these mountains are still underwater when it comes to sea level. The Galilee is about 600 feet below sea level, and that's just kind of a cool thing as well. Verse 17, and when they saw him, they've come to the mountain. They've found Jesus waiting for them. The appointment has been kept by Jesus. Now, did they know that this encounter would reset everything they thought about Jesus? For here again he is. He revealed himself in Jerusalem to them in his risen state. And now he reveals himself once again to them in a more intimate fashion. And it says, verse 17, when they saw him, they worshipped him. But some doubted. Think of all the things that Jesus has done on mountaintops. He's taken some of his disciples up on the Mount of Transfiguration, where they saw Jesus in an altered form of great holiness with Moses and Elijah in the presence of his Father. And great things were said. Great things were witnessed. Think of the things that Jesus has done on the Mount of Beatitudes. Think of the things that Jesus did on the Mount of Olives. Why these mountains? Why this sense? And I think they're points of faith. They're points of faith for all. I plea for mountaintop experiences for you. I pray that Jesus leads you to a mountain epiphany of who he is, just for him to share with you intimately the sense of his presence, the sense of his love, the great enduring mercy and grace of God. I never get that sense unless I'm alone with Jesus. And some of the great forks in the road of my life, I've done just that. I've driven to mountains, I've sat on the rocks, and God has spoken to me. I pray you have those events. I think that's really Steve's heart in his Into the Wilderness ministry. But some doubted. Interestingly enough, some doubted. I don't think that they were specifically speaking of Peter. Peter certainly doubted. He denied even to the point of cursing. Could this be Thomas? It's more than that, I think. This is a sense with Jesus and his disciples. Listen, here I am. And some, maybe not all of them, fell down and worshiped him. What will it be like when you first see Jesus? I guarantee you I'm going to be on his feet. You know, I can only imagine what Jesus' feet looked like after walking 120 miles on flaps of leather. You know, there's no pedicures in those days. Those gnarly toenails and dirty little crevices. It's gross. But it's Jesus. It's Jesus. And I'll take everything I can get from my Savior. Everything I can get. Some doubted. They looked on him even then. And they probably thought, you know what, you're still at it. What's the deal, man? In truth, in this church today, there are some that are probably thinking, he's still at it. Is that the only thing you can talk about? I mean, there's more entertaining churches in this city. There's places where we don't even have to open the Bible. You're still at it. What's the deal? Jesus is alive. Amen. And he's coming soon. And I have but one heart. And that's, as Paul said, to present Christ and him crucified. And Jesus came and he spoke to them. And he said, I love this. All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. There is nothing that exists, either in the seen or unseen world, whether it be in the far extents of the universe or in places that scientists only dream of thinking about, far beyond the capacity of anything that we could discover. Yet God is still omnipotently over all that in his holiness and in his truth. Jesus said, every portion of authority has been given to me. Who gave it to him? I didn't elect him to have that. The Father in heaven has given it to his Son. Why? Because he has become victorious over sin, over death, and over the grave. Jesus says, go. And he says, when you go, as you go, that's more literally what Jesus is saying, make disciples, train, teach, pursue people in the pathway of Christ. Your life is an example of Christ. Your life shows others that there is a glorious life that can be lived right now in the abundance of Christ. Yes, in this world there will be tribulations, but be of good cheer. Jesus said, I have overcome. I have authority over everything in this earth. All you need to do is lean on me. Lean on me. Make disciples of all nations. Go everywhere that you might go. It's been said that every Christian is a missionary, and I believe that. You can be a missionary whether you work for, you know, Culligan or any other place like that. I don't know why Culligan came to mind. You're a missionary, and you're exampling the life of Christ in you. And the faith that you have in things that cannot be seen is amazing to others. It renders a peace that passes all understanding. And they're in awe of the peace of God in you. What's wrong with that guy? I don't know. He's religious, I guess. But wouldn't it be nice to be like him? I think it would be. Next he says, be obedient. And oh, he says, baptize. Baptize, yeah. Set them apart. Baptism, in its purest sense, certainly includes water baptism, but also includes Holy Spirit baptism. I want you to know that it is important for every Christian to be baptized in water, to be immersed, to declare by confession that Jesus Christ is yours. And you have given room for him to sit alone on the throne of your life. I love that. And friend, if you've never been baptized in water, you need to be baptized. But friends, don't think that I have to do it. Any one of you can do it. Find a bathtub. Find a pool. Find an ocean. Find a full gutter. Whatever it is, get them wet. Get the idea? Fourthly, be obedient in all things. C.H. Spurgeon said, we are not to invent anything new, nor to change anything to suit the current of the age, but to teach the baptized believers to observe all things whatsoever our divine King has commanded. There is goodness in the study of the Gospels. There is goodness, and I include Acts as a gospel as well. There is goodness in studying the life of Christ because we learn to be more like Jesus. And I pray that these 2 years have been meaningful to you in that. We conclude with one of the great encouragements that Jesus has given to any of us. See, the world will abandon you. See, the world will desert you. Even family, nothing hurts more than a close friend stabbing you in the back. Nothing hurts more than to think that, you know what, I'm alone in this world. And friends, Christmas time, people feel more alone than any other time in the year. Jesus says, behold, listen closely. I am with you always. In other words, there's not a time, dear baptized believer, there is not a time that you will ever spend by yourself without Jesus by your side. And by the way, he has also sent the power of the Holy Spirit to come along your side. That's actually what his name means, parakletos, which means to be called alongside you. Isn't it wonderful to think that at this moment right now, there's someone sitting next to you, Helen, besides Carolyn. Every time you open the Bible, think of this your next devotional period. And I hope it's today or tomorrow morning. You open the Bible, and in that instant you know, I just put my arms about my Holy Spirit, my Savior. Thank you. I am not alone. And by the way, I am with the omnipotent, all-powerful, glorious King of this universe that holds all authority in heaven and on earth. And all that I ask, he is more than willing to accomplish for the sake of the kingdom of Jesus Christ. The last word of this amazing gospel is a word that I pray that you join me with me in saying, amen. Amen. It is good, isn't it? Friends, this morning, two groups of people I want to speak to in conclusion as we pray. First of all, to Christians. Listen, Jesus knows exactly where you've been, and he knows perhaps how far you've diverted your life, taken a detour, and how long he has waited for you to return to his Father's house. Oh, Christian, know this. Jesus seeks you right now. Jesus seeks an appointment of intimacy with you right now. And dear friend, he wants to tell you how much he loves you, how much of his power can be yours in a life of holiness and truth. I want to speak to people who perhaps have found their way here this morning without knowing Jesus. And I want to tell you that Jesus loves you. That Jesus has, in fact, given his life for you. And if you want the joy that we as Christians have, possess, own this morning, isn't it wonderful to know that it can be yours as well? just by praying for Jesus to come into your life. Let's first of all pray for Christians. Close your head. Close your heads and bow your eyes. Christians, we pray, Father in heaven, oh, thank you. Thank you for your glory. Thank you for your power. Thank you for your friendship. It astonishes me. I'm undone by your glorious presence. Who am I outside of you? I am nothing. Oh, Jesus, come and find me. Oh, Jesus, come and rule in me. Oh, come, Jesus, and let me enjoy that life you've always intended for me. Oh, Jesus, mighty God, send the power of your Holy Spirit again and set me free, I pray. Amen. And now to people who don't recall in their life a time when they asked Jesus into it, I ask you today, isn't this the right time? Isn't this the perfect opportunity for you to submit, to surrender your heart to Jesus? He looks for you. He waits for you. He longs for you. A simple prayer opens that door for him to come in as he promised and have fellowship with you forever. Please repeat this prayer after me. Say it out loud so that your own ears hear what your heart is confessing. Father in heaven, I invite Jesus to come, O Savior, and wash me with your blood. Cleanse me from my sin. Take all unrighteousness from me. Make me a new creature. Put a new heart in me. Come, Holy Spirit, into this new temple of my heart and live in me. Give me power to resist what my flesh wants to do. Give me power to resist what the world wants me to do. Give me power to resist even what the devil wants me to do. Oh, Jesus, take control of my life. Come and be my Lord and Master, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Well, I hope you enjoyed that broadcast. I pray that the Word of God affected your life and will go forth from your head to your heart and begin to affect your family, affect your neighborhood, affect your workplace. We welcome you to join us on Sunday mornings at 8:30 and 10:30, but only if you're not attending a church elsewhere in this community. I welcome you also to consider how the Lord would use you with this word and in His Spirit to do something eternal in these last days. God bless you. Once again, this is Paul Berry, Senior Pastor of Calvary Chapel.